about being chosen and ordained to be highly productive and successful. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that part later, but what I want to do is just go right into the scriptures of John chapter 15 and beginning at verse number 1. And I want to show you, according to the scriptures, that this is God's will for all of his citizens of the kingdom. Amen?
Amen.
So we're going to read this in John chapter 15, beginning at verse number 1. It says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. This is Jesus speaking. He said, I am the true vine. I'm the genuine vine. I'm the real vine. He didn't say, I am a vine. He said, I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Husband means the owner. He is the one that owns and one that care for the vineyard. Now, when he say vine, he's speaking of vineyard. Okay? I want you to think of vineyard. I want you to think of vine. I want you to think of grapes. Amen. When you hear fruit. I'm going to give you an image of it in a minute. He says, every branch in me that beareth not fruit, now be taken away. Every branch that is in Christ, that is non-productive, he says that the Father takes that branch away. He takes the branch away because that branch that's in him is not productive. We can be in Christ and still be non-productive.
Amen.
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 And so what happens is that God is not like a lot of us where we just keep holding on to dead stuff. Unproductive stuff. Many of us do. Amen. Somehow or another, we get some kind of attachment. I don't know if it's some kind of whatever it is, emotional attachment to something. But, you know, I have a thing like if something is dead, it's dead. Amen. Well, here's what the Bible said. Every branch in me that bears not fruit, he take it away. And every branch that's in me, he say, every branch that bears fruit, he does what? Purges it that it may bring what?
More fruit.
Bring forth more fruit. Now, I want to do this real quickly because God said you need to share this with the people. Understanding the purpose of God's purging. Write that down. We need to understand the purpose of God's purging. And you're going to see this, and it should bless you if you are here to be blessed, so that you can be a blessing. When you understand the purpose of God's purging, you will not fight against his purging. You will not struggle against his purging. As a matter of fact, you will welcome the purging of God in your life. You won't get so quick to run from the things that are uncomfortable that God will take you through. God takes you through uncomfortable situations and circumstances because he's trying to get some things out of you and off of you. God will move people out of your life while you're trying to hold on to them. God says they're no longer purposeful in your life. And you're still trying to grab onto something that God said, whatever they're supposed to do in your life at that time, it's over. Amen. But we don't understand that, so we think that everything that happened, you know, everybody that's in our life is there for ever, not necessarily. They're just there sometimes for a season, some for a reason. We need to understand God's purging. Now, understand, I put that in there on purpose, understanding God's purging. Yeah, I'm going to tell you why I said that. Y'all want to know why I said that? That's a good question. I said that because sometimes we'll purge the people that God never chose to purge.
Come on now.
We'll take people out of our lives that really rub us the wrong way. And they rub you the wrong way because they're trying to get some things off of you. It's not comfortable when people rub you the wrong way, but they're trying to let you see some things. They're trying to get you into a position where you can fit into God's plan. You got too many rough edges, so somebody got to be in your life to kind of, you know, have smooth those ends. And it may be just the person that keep you, you know, you know how sometimes you're around someone and you say, man, every time I get around this person, they just make me feel uncomfortable. I ain't gonna hang around them no more. You'll be surprised that may be the person you need to have. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Can I make a confession to you all? Who make the confession to you? And he didn't know I was gonna do this, but I knew I had to do this. Skip Smith there is a personal trainer. And, you know, it's like when I'm training with him, he has a certain way that make me want to get up 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning and go train. Times when I don't feel like training, he'll say something to me and make me train. There's times where I'm sore and I still go out and train. There are times when I had a rough evening and I still got to get up early in the morning? Well, here's what I'm saying. He is serious about what he does. And I've already admitted that I'm going to have to call him again because I got some plans that I need to get in. I want to get in a certain condition, and I'm going to have him to help me. And it ain't going to be easy.
Amen.
That brother going to have me doing stuff. And I mean, it's like, it's work. Well, sometimes we don't want trainers in our lives that's going to make us do something to take us out of our comfort.
Come on now.
We want them to be in agreement with what we're already doing, even though we're not getting results. We're not productive, we're not successful, but I have a granddaughter who told me, I want you to train me, Papa, but I want to tell you how. Now, I don't want to lift weights. I don't want no muscles. And I don't want to do this, and I don't want to do that. I said, well, you better get someone else to train you. No, I want you. No, you don't. You don't want me because you're not going to have me training you, and you're going to tell me how to train you too. Amen. You better get somebody else. Amen. Plus, I ain't charging too. My point is that sometimes we kind of pull away from people who sometimes irritate us. And that person who may irritate us just make us just feel uncomfortable with where we are. Who somehow or another challenges us. Some of us don't like to be challenged. How many of y'all will be honest and say, I really don't like to be challenged? How many of y'all be honest enough to say that? That's how many of y'all be honest enough to say that. That's how many of y'all say that. Well, a lot of us don't like to be challenged. Let's be real, right? The reason why we don't like to be challenged is because we like our comfort zone. We don't want no one to disturb. We work real hard to get to this level, and we think that that's enough. But my question is that all God has for you? And is that all God wants you to do? Because we say that we belong to God. We're not ourselves any longer. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature, right?
Amen.
So old things pass away, we hold on to become new, and all things are of God. So we belong to God, but we still want to have say-so on what we do, how long we do it, when we do it, where we do it. And God said, not if I paid the price for you. And that's what we have to struggle with. That's why there's a difference between religious and the kingdom message. The religious message is, well, just keep on doing. God understand what he told us to do and what he created us to do. And God is looking for us to do that. He expects that. Amen? Now, again, you got to break that mindset. You are not. It's not a democracy. It is a kingdom. That's the government that we're under. Everybody who gives their lives to the Lord, you're under a different government, even though we don't understand it. And that's why I'm trying to help you understand. Let me get back to the word. Y'all ready back there from me? So, understanding the purpose of God's purging, this is going to help us. It helped me. Okay? Listen to this. The word purge, it means to rid of whatever is impure or undesirable. To cleanse, to purify. That's the purpose of purging. Understand that he has a purpose for that. He's trying to rid us of whatever is impure, whatever is undesirable. He wants to cleanse us and purify us. It is to clear of imputed guilt. To clear away or wipe out legally any and offense, accusation, etc., by atonement or other suitable action. Now, let me help you understand this. That, let's say you're doing real well right now in the kingdom of God. And what we don't understand is that God is saying, okay, you are doing okay right now. But your life can improve if I was to rid you of some things. If I was to get some of these accusations, these offenses off of you, you can be free to now be moved, be used by me and be more productive. Listen to me. Anything that's not producing in your life is dead weight. If it's not producing, it's dead weight. Amen?
Amen.
I can run faster and longer if I didn't carry excess weight. Y'all agree with that?
Amen.
I could help more people if I had better health.
Amen.
if I had the finances.
Amen.
I could make more of an impact if I get rid of all this excess stuff that's taking up and eating up my time.
Yes.
I could be more effective. See, and when we let, when we trust God by His Spirit to purge us, God is purging us of stuff that has no significance, no real importance in our lives. We got to let Him have His way.
Yes.
We have to quit evaluating our future by someone's opinion.
Amen.
Amen.
There are people who want to keep you where they can. They really don't want to see you succeed because they feel like if you succeed, then they won't be able to have the access that they have in your life. And they don't really care about you. They just want you to be available just in case they need you. And you have a higher purpose. God has more in store for you. God wants you to reach people that some people would never reach. And so you may be the one that has that assignment.
Amen.
So you can't be tied down with people who just want to waste your time and have no real value for their own lives or any value for their own self. And they're going to try to take your time. You have to be careful with it. You have to be careful because people will do it. They will do it in a heartbeat.
Amen?
Because they don't understand that they have a purpose, but they don't realize their purpose. And so what they're going to do, they're going to, you know, kind of interfere with yours. You have to be mindful that I'm here because God called me to be here. I'm on His time. I'm on His schedule. I'm on His agenda.
Yeah.
I just can't do whatever y'all want me to do. I got to do what God wants me to do.
Amen.
And when you get to that point, I'm going to tell you, you'll find yourself where God is going to purge you from some stuff and from some people. And you're going to find out that the people who walked out on you, they didn't even realize. You think that they think they're hurting you. They need your faith.
Amen.
You're going to send them a thank you card. Amen. Because sometimes you don't realize just how much time and energy that they have eaten up from you and taken from you. Sometimes you just need to say, you know, open the door for them. Thank you. I know you got to go. I like something T.D. Jakes said. He said, I got the gift of goodbye. When people want to say goodbye to me, he said, I'm anointed to say goodbye. But we try to hold on to people, and God said, I'm trying to get these people out of your life because you can't be what I need you to be. Many of us, our success is not coming because we are tied to people who don't want to see us succeed, and we don't know that. And we don't want to let the people out of our lives, and God say, I'm doing this. We got to let God do what He has to do.
Amen.
Let Him purge you. Let Him take away those things. I mean, we love Him to take away debt. Amen. If God wants to say, in order for you to do what I need you to do, Brother Mac, I got to make you debt free, you'd be glad for that, wouldn't you? Everybody would. But then there are people that God said, in order for me to do what I need you to do, I got to move some of these people out. We're struggling with that. We're struggling. Because we feel like we need them. And God is saying, no, what you need is what I put in your life.
Amen.
And the people that God put in our lives, oftentimes, may not be the people that we would choose.
Come on.
Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Don't lean to your own understanding. All your ways acknowledge Him. He should direct your path. The step of a righteous man are ordered by the Lord. Who's ordering your steps? Who are you listening to? Hallelujah.
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 See, I'm serious about this.
Amen.
I want God, and here's another thing, imputed guilt. Guilt. You know, if you're walking around and you got this heavy, guilty thing about you, and you feel like, man, I can't really do what God, because if God want me to do this, because I'm still struggling with this. I'm still struggling with that. You know, we need to get in the face of God, in the presence of God, and let God purge us of that guilt by the blood of Jesus. That He would create, not only the act of disobedience, but the very guilt of disobedience. So we can be free.
Yes.
How many of y'all actually, you don't have to raise your hand on this, but how many of y'all actually failed to say something to someone because you were feeling so convicted and condemned?
Come on.
And you end up where you can't even set another person free because you're holding stuff. You need to be free from it.
Amen.
God said, I need to get that out of you. He said, you're fruitful, but that ain't all you can be. Many of us, we have self. We have people say, man, you're doing good. I don't know why you're complaining. You're doing good. The Bible says this. Be not conformed to this world, but be transformed, that you may prove that which is good, acceptable, and perfect. God's trying to get you from your good to his best. We can't say yes to the best of God because we keep saying yes to the good. You got to learn to say no to the good so you can say yes to the best. Amen. Good enough, not good enough.
Amen.
If God has best.
That's right.
Why do we settle for good enough? Because that's the mindset. That's good enough. No, not if God got something better. Amen. And then when I get his better, I ain't going to be satisfied. I want his best. And if he got best for me, I'm going for best. Amen. I don't care what everybody else say. You get upset? No, I'm going for God's best. I want his best. So I need to know, Lord, what do I need to do? And it's let me purge you. Lord, you move whatever you need to move out of my life.
Come on.
Because if you move it, I don't need it. I don't want to hold on to something that you say I don't need.
Amen, amen.
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 So I want to make sure, just like if a person get ready to do something and they say they have an offense, have a record or something, and they say, well, you know what? We got to move. We got to get this record, get this person clean from this record so he can be used by God. You have people who have records of you, recordings, memories of you. You know, sometimes you go back to people, you know, family.
Yeah.
Sometimes, can I say this to you all? Sometimes family, folks, you know, you can't let family evaluate you.
Amen.
You know what's so funny about it? You know, I'm a grandfather, and I have family. Yeah, man, I remember when you used to, man, what are you talking about? They bring back old, you know what I'm talking about? Like, that person don't live there anymore.
Right.
And man, you can't go to family folks. Now, I mean, you got family folks that's encouraging, but you got some family folks who already come me. Man, you remember when you did this and you failed? You remember when you did that and that didn't work? You remember? People love to remind you of your failures.
Right.
Amen. It may be time to get rid of them.
Amen.
It may be time to get purged from them. Amen.
Amen.
All that stuff that you don't need. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's move on. Y'all heard that enough, right? Nobody says. I want to talk about fruitful, because I want you to understand fruitful. That's why I use the word productive, so you understand bearing fruit in abundance. In Genesis, it says, and God created male and female and said, let them be fruitful. Fruitful, this is what it means, to bear fruit in abundance. It means to produce good and profitable results. We need to get to a point where we are profitable. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. We're in church. We've been spending 30, 40 years in church. Are you profitable to the kingdom of God, or are you just holding up space on the King's Highway on the way to God to call you home? Pastor, I want you to pray my strength in the Lord. I've been on the King's Highway a long time.
Come on.
I can make heaven my home. Pray my strength in the Lord. We do that kind of stuff. It's cliche. You know what I'm saying? But you've been, yeah. You know how people say, man, you're in the way. Yeah, I've been in the way. Yeah, I know you've been in the way. I've been in the way a long time. I know. Either leave, follow, or get the heck out of the way. Amen. He's talking about highly effective or abundantly productive. That means fertile.
Amen.
Yeah.
Fertile. You know, back in the day, when a husband and wife, notice I said this, husband and wife, I didn't say a man and a woman. Husband and wife. Boy, some of these, because we came out of a big family. My mom was fertile. There were 9 of us. Amen. Boy, it wasn't that. And I thought we had a big family until I met some brothers got 15, 16. I said, whoa, the fertile.
Right.
Amen. I heard one lady say one time, my husband looked at me, I get pregnant. Very fertile. Listen to me, very fertile. Well, when you are fertile, that means that you are highly productive somewhere or another. Okay? Now, we're not always talking about pregnancy, but you know, all of us should be fertile ground.
Amen.
Anybody that invested us should get a harvest. Anyone that invested us should be able to see something that's going to bring a result, a good result. Amen.
Amen.
It shouldn't be where people invest in us, invest time, invest effort and stuff in us, and then we produce nothing.
That's right.
Some of us don't produce anything. We have conversation, Pastor, I want to meet with you. Talk with me for 2 hours and walk out of there and don't produce nothing.
Come on now.
Don't do anything. I mean, I don't have a problem with people not doing what I say. It's just, why waste my time if you're not going to do what I say? I'm like, Jesus, why call me Lord, Lord, and do not what I say? If you have confidence in me, where you want to sit up a meeting with me, and you want to hear from my experience, and hear from whatever I want to share with you, whatever, I'm going to give you the best I can give you. Now, if it don't work for you, that's fine, but at least try it.
Come on now, man.
Amen. If you're doing better than I am, then don't even bother. Let me come to you. But if I'm here to help you, then why not at least say, well, let me try out and see. Because many of us have a certain way that we look at things, and that's the only way we know. It's our perception.
That's true.
Amen. And I'm saying that there are some ways that, you know, God will show us, and we need to understand that maybe this is the way that I need to go. Maybe God is calling me to be more disciplined. Maybe he's purging me so that I can be more fruitful. Maybe I can be open to someone who's not going to say things just to make me feel good. Because I'm going to tell you something. You may walk out of my office at times and you may not like what I say.
Come on, Pastor.
But you didn't come in there to get popular.
Amen.
You came to get information.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
So I'm going to give you the best information I can give you. But it may not be something you like. See, when God speak of production and being effective and being successful, see, we look at it like this. Now, this is a vineyard. Look at that flowing grapes. Look good, don't it?
Yeah.
We are happy. Hallelujah. Look at me. I'm producing. But that's not what God wants you to see. God said that's what you like. Everybody else approve of you. People approve of you. Everybody happy because they see it. But God said, that's not what I see in you. This is what I see in you.
Yeah.
And if you look at that, there are all kinds. Look at that. Look at all those grapes. Look at that. He said, there is more in you.
Yes.
You're looking at one cluster,
yeah.
And God says,
yeah.
You're happy with that. He said, but I got so much more.
Yes.
I put too much in you.
Yes. Amen.
Amen. I'm telling you. This will mess some people's mind when I say, when God created us, it's like a business. God said, I invested so much in you, which I'm going to get into. I invested a lot in you. I mean, look what I've done. Not just to bring you here in the earth and to give you over all the works of my hand, but guess what else he said? He said, even when you messed up, he said, look what I paid for you, the price I paid you. Look at how valuable you are. Look at the price I paid to get you back. Look at what I had to let my son die to get you back. So I sacrificed my very best, my only begotten son, and we don't even realize what God done when he sent Jesus to die for our sin. He gave us his very best. He said, look what I invested in you. And we're playing with his time. We're playing with him. It's like it's not a big deal.
Come on.
Thank you, Lord.
It's like, you know, well, what's that church over? Well, you know, well, I got to get out of here, Pastor. So what? I got to go eat. Yeah. Been doing that pretty good. I didn't look at nobody there. All right. See, when I see productive, I want to be highly productive. I don't want to be, if this is all I am, and God said, that's just the beginning. He said, I got to purge you because this is what I expect of you. I mean, it's so much more. And I refuse to cheat God. If God got something else for me that he wants me to do, I want to do everything he put in me to do.
Amen.
Many of God's people are often influenced by good or even noble intentions. And what I mean by that is that people will quickly tell you, well, I intended this. I intended that. And so we forget what Jesus said because we get caught up in what, God's going to do this. And God's going to do that. And God sent me here to tell you that he's going to do this. God told me to tell you. I said, wait, let me see what you got. Let me see what kind of fruit you have. See, let me see how you live. I mean, because people have good intentions in what they're going to do. But that's not what Jesus said. Jesus stated, where by their fruits you should know them. He didn't say they are known by what they promised to produce. Only by what they have produced. Y'all need to be writing that down. I mean, because we tend to listen to people, ooh, he said he going to do this. He said he going to do that. Wait a minute. Look at what they have produced. Maybe all they produced was words. feel like? Do you know more people respect someone they never met than the person who they've been seeing all their lives? Why do you think Jesus said this, that a prophet's wife I'm except among his own kin? When you're around your own kin people and your own folks, you know, people don't honor you the way strangers will. Strangers appreciate you more than people who know you. And it's not that they see something bad, it's just they're familiar. You know, oh, that ain't even Pastor Griffin said that. But let somebody else come and say the same thing. Who did you know what the Lord said to their brother? Is that what the Lord said? Yeah, but I mean, I know because, see, you don't know nothing about that person's life.
Come on.
Maybe if you knew something about that person's life, you wouldn't listen to anything they say. At least y'all see me on a regular basis.
Amen.
You all see me on a regular basis. You see me when the sun is shining, when it's snowing.
Amen. Amen.
Y'all see me when it's time to have picnics and when it's time to work.
Amen.
Y'all see me in labor and in play.
Come on.
Amen.
Amen.
Y'all see me when things are going good, when things are not going good. What I try to present is consistency and stay fruitful even when the season is not right for it. There's a difference between a seasoned Christian and a seasonal Christian. Those people who are seasonal can only produce when the season is right. But the person who's a seasoned person, that means whether the weather is right, whether it's popular or unpopular, they still produce it. They still showing up. You got people that when things go bad, they don't show up. When things get a little tough, they don't show up. It's almost as if people who got the call of God on their life, as if they somehow or another, that they are exempt from going through trials and tests and persecution and hardship and people deserting them and the bad. You don't know, Pastor. You don't understand. Yes, I do. You don't understand when you, because you misjudge me, but you don't never get misjudged. I get misjudged all the time. But the thing is that, what am I going to do? I'm going to still produce. I'm going to still produce because God didn't give me a season to produce. He said, you got to produce in any season. In all seasons. I got to stay productive. I got to stay consistent. Even when I want to throw up both hands. Anybody ever want to throw up both hands sometimes? Come on, talk to me. We in church. Have you ever wanted to just give up and say, the heck with all the souls? But you say, even when you sin that you know you're not going to do it. You know, man, that's just my head talking. Don't tell anyone.
There you go.
Yeah, there's a difference. Well, how many of y'all have jobs? I'm quitting. I'm quitting this job. And you stayed another 10 years. I thought you was going to quit. Yeah. What I'm trying to tell you is, you know, it's something about you that you know that, you know, that's how I feel. This person got up my last year, the boss, if he said one more thing to me, and that's how we feel. But God said, I have you there for a purpose. And you have to realize that, folks. Amen?
Amen.
So when people say something, look at what they produce. If you can't see what they produce, then all it is an empty promise until you see what they produce. Amen.
Amen.
Because only what they have produced is what they are known about. We must always be careful to investigate what they have produced in their past. Investigate. See if they're talking. See if they're walking the talk and talking the walk. See if they or they're just talking the talk. See what they're walking. See what they live. Now I'm talking about. I'm not talking about on the surface. I mean, what kind of consistency? Amen.
Amen.
Folks, in Matthew 7:15, it says, "Beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep clothing, but inwardly they are what?
Ravening
wolves." He said, you should know them by their what?
Fruit.
By what they are producing. Do men gather grapes or thorns or figs or thistles? He says, even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit. But a corrupt tree bringeth forth what kind of fruit?
Evil.
A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. Wherefore, by their fruits ye shall know them. By their fruits ye should know them. Never debate what kind of tree it is. Just pay attention, careful attention to their fruit. The fruit it bears, friends, and you will see that their fruit is going to reveal who they are.
Yes.
You can't separate what a tree produces from who they are. Don't argue that. That's a fir tree. That's an apple tree. No, I don't agree. Well, let, just be careful. Just wait until it produces.
Right.
It's not a bird. It's not a bird tree producing apples.
Amen.
If it produces apples, it's an apple tree.
Amen.
Well, argue with the tree. Just let me see what you produce.
Oh,
yeah, I don't worry about people. A lot of people say whatever they want. I say, let me see what they produce. And if they produce what they say they are, then I say, okay, well, this is genuine.
There you go.
Amen.
Amen.
But we want to make everything so, well, I heard from the Spirit of the Lord. No. Let me see what you produce.
There you go.
Yeah, you can talk anything. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, we move on. Remember, we are known only by the fruit that we produce. Only. Only. Verse number 3, going back to John, chapter 15. He says, now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me. What did that mean? Live. Make your abode in me. This is by the Spirit of the Lord. You can't, now Jesus physically don't live in you, but the Spirit of the Lord does.
Yes.
And he says, abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine. No more can ye, except you abide in me. Look what he says. He says, I am the vine. Now he's telling us who he is. He's giving us his credentials. And he's saying, but you are the branches. You are not the vine. You are the branches. He that abided in me and I in him, the same bringing forth what kind of fruit?
Much fruit.
For without me, you can do what?
Nothing.
What he's saying is that you can't really produce real success, lasting success, without him. He said, what you are doing, you can have temporary success.
Come on, Pastor.
Because you got your efforts in temporary conditions, temporary people, temporary substance. He said, the stuff that you're producing without me, he said, it's not going to be lasting, it's not eternal, and it's not going to be there when you need it. You can't trust it. Amen.
Amen.
Because it's temporary. Everything temporary is subject to change.
Right. Amen.
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 He said, but if a man abided not in me, he is cast forth as a branch that is withered, and men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. They are burned. That's what he said. Now, he says, now verse number 7, if you abide in me and my words, now I want to get this in you before I move on. Now, be real with yourself, folks. Don't say stuff that you don't mean and only mean what you say. And I'm saying when you're talking to God. It doesn't matter what you say to me. But just when you're praying and you're speaking to God and you're asking God about certain things, about why certain prayers not get answered, why certain things didn't happen, or why certain things did happen, things like that. Let me tell you what I used to think. I'm confessing something to you. He said, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you should ask what you will, and it should be done unto you. Now, I had actually used to read that everything that I asked, that God will do what I asked him, whatever it is. Okay? If I abide in you. But I realized that we're talking about levels. I'm going to be honest with you. I don't know about you. But I haven't reached the level yet that everything I asked of God, he has given me. I've come to realize that he didn't say if you just give your life to the Lord. He said if you abide in me.
Come on.
If you make your abode, if you live in me. See, let's be real. What do we do when we're not in church? How do we live when we are not around each other? What is our life really like? And what about his word? He said, and my words abide in you. Or are we speaking our thoughts, our words? Are we being real with this? Are we actually being real with this? There is a brokenness that has to take place in our lives as believers in Christ Jesus. Listen to me, everybody. There is a brokenness that has to take place. We got to quit thinking like somehow or another because we're in a country where the government is democratic or democracy. We got to look at this. We're in a kingdom. When you get elected Lord, you become a part of a kingdom. In a kingdom, the government is ran different. God owns everything. A king owns everything. The territory, everything. And so, when he sent Jesus, he said, now I'm going to pay a price for you. He said, my son is going to pay his life for your ransom. Now listen to what he's saying. He said, now, if you abide in me, if you live in me, if you allow me to work in you and through rule you by my spirit, and my words abide in you. He said, you get to a point where you're not there yet, you get to a point where you ask whatever you will, it's going to be done.
Amen.
But if we're not there yet, that means we're still growing.
Yes. Yes.
We're still growing.
Amen.
It's not over. Just because I've been asking God for something for a while, it didn't happen. But I realized it's not God.
Right.
I got to keep going because God said, whatever you will. Now, there are a lot of things that God did answer. See, I'm not going to throw everything out and say, well, he never. No, he answered a lot of my prayer.
Amen.
But I'm not going to sit here and say he answered every prayer.
Come on now.
And if he did, there must have been, someone must have been no. Because, listen to me real carefully, I'm trying to tell you something. God is trying to get us to a certain level.
Amen.
To handle what we are believing him for. We got to understand that what we're doing is because this is what he wants for our life, because he owns us. Or we're doing it because this is what we want. What is more stronger, his will or our will? Be real with yourself. Is it God's will that we're trying to please, or is it his will? Or our will? Which one are we more conscious of? Which one are we more concerned about? Because God says, I have some things for you that I want to bring in your life that you would. I mean, it'll blow your mind. He said, but I got to get you to a point.
Right. Amen.
He said, I abide in you, and my words abide in you. And then you ask whatever you will, and it's going to be done. That's what he said. Herein is my Father glorified. Look at this, that you bear much fruit. How many of us are not bearing much fruit? How many of us have settled because this is good enough? We live on good enough evidence. Because we left not enough evidence. And then we went to just enough evidence. And we're still trying to get to more than enough, but we stuck on good enough. And we're happy on good enough because here's how we compare. Well, I ain't doing as bad as them over there.
Come on.
I may not be where God wants me, but I ain't what I was. You know, and I'm saying, well, we have got stuck. And honestly, the reason why you are here at this ministry, because I'm trying to get you unstuck.
Come on now.
Amen.
I'm trying to help you get unstuck. Amen. That's why I put some stuff out there. I'm putting some stuff. You don't have to stay stuck. All you got to do is make your mind up that it's time to make some changes.
Yes.
Come to church for a change.
Amen.
Here he is, my Father glorified. You don't glorify God just by Lord. Be ye glorified. We think that that's glorifying God. We're going to offer the church glorifying God. No, he said, this is how you glorify me, that you bear much fruit.
Come on.
You want to glorify me? Be highly productive. This is what he said. If you really want to bring glory to me, he said, be highly productive.
Yes.
Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify the Father which is in heaven. You want to glorify God? Then, to be about the Father's business, but you can't be about the business that you don't know nothing about. You have to realize this is what God is requiring of us. And then he said, then shall you be my disciples. Disciples bear much fruit.
Amen. Amen.
That's the difference. Verse number 9. We move on. As the Father has loved me, listen to this, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. He went from bearing fruit to love. He didn't change the subject. Look what he's doing. He said, if you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandment and abide in his love. Now, we're talking about love. We're talking about God's love. We're talking about unconditional love. How many of y'all love me? Raise your hand. How many of y'all love me? How many of y'all ain't gonna raise your hand? I think I'm gonna attract. I'm saying it has nothing to do with who I am. It has to do with who you are.
Right. Come on now. There it
is. So if you don't love me, it's not my issue, it's yours. God didn't love us because of who we are. He loved us because of who he is. The Bible says that God is love.
Right.
So we're trying to think, I don't know if he were loving, if she were loving or not. Just imagine if we had waited on God to make us until it was worth it. His love. We wouldn't be in a mess. So the kind of love that he's talking about, he said, as I have loved you.
Thank you, Lord.
And we haven't learned to do that yet. And yet we still say that Well, I believe I'm abiding in him. No, if you abide in Christ, you love people regardless of what they
want. Come on now.
You can't forgive people?
Amen.
That's an issue. You say, these things have I spoken unto you that my joy, look what he says, my joy might remain in you and that your joy might be full. That my joy, this is what Jesus said, that my joy may remain in you and that your joy may be full. Joy is different from happiness.
Amen.
Many of us don't have strength because the joy of the Lord is our strength. The joy of the Lord is where I don't understand everything, but I'm going to keep going. I'm going to keep going. Every time I say, man, I'm tired, I'm ready to give up, but I'm going to keep going anyway. Every time somebody get on my last nerve, I don't know, maybe I'm going another one, but I'm going to keep on going anyway. Maybe I got another nerve. Maybe it wasn't my last. I don't know. But I just want you to know that it's worth it. Folks, we got to get to a point, it's worth it. It ain't over yet. There's another chapter. God's still writing. I'm still living. Than a man laid out his life for his friends. Ooh, I love this part. because he said, you're my friends.
Thank you, Lord.
Wait a minute, wait a minute. There's a two-letter word there, y'all.
Yeah.
You do what's in my command. So he said, if you don't do what I tell you, he said, you're really not friends. Have you ever had a friend that take advantage of your friendship?
Come on now.
You know, they feel like that they friends, so they should have to do what you ask them to do. I don't want friends like that. I mean, really. I don't want to be no one's mentor. I don't even want to be no one's pastor. That if we become friends, now you can't do what I say because you're too familiar.
Come on.
Right.
You make me want to pull back.
Right.
I mean, you know what happens in families all the time. Yeah, it happens in families all the time. You know, you got kids, grandkids, you got husband and wife. Sometimes they don't understand that when you're in the church, this is your anointing, it's your call. You know, maybe at home they dad. Maybe at home they sister and brother. Maybe at home they husband and wife. But in the church, you know, okay, now I'm functioning under my call. I need to do so and so, so and so. Don't talk to me like I'm your brother now. I'm your pastor.
Amen.
Now, if you can't see me as pastor, maybe you need to go somewhere where you can submit.
There you go.
Amen.
Right.
Amen.
Not that you try to get people out there, but you need to let people understand that this got nothing to do with friendship now. We're talking, I don't need all that pushback. And you don't need it either.
Amen.
Amen. People need to realize that we're about God's business.
Yes.
But I ain't gonna let you dehumanize me. I'm a human being.
Come on now.
But I'm not doing what I'm supposed to do. I'm ready to have fun. I'm ready to relax. I don't want to be tensed all day. I'm not gonna be pastoring 24/7.
Come on.
I want to be me sometimes. I want to have some fun. I want to laugh. We have some fun at the appreciation.
Amen.
People laughing at me because I'm over in the corner dancing by myself. Doing the two-step by myself. And I wasn't bothering nobody. Here people got cameras on me. I say, all these people on the dance floor, why are you looking at me? I'm looking at you on the business. Then I had somebody trying to blackmail me. What about these bitches pass out to me? But he said, you are my friends if you do whatever I command you. Henceforth, I call you not servants. See, that's why I keep telling people, I say, in the kingdom of God, he don't see you as a servant, he sees you as a citizen. As a citizen.
Amen.
You serve, but that's not how he sees you as a citizen. For the servant knoweth not what his Lord does. But I called you friends, for all things I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. Everything that Jesus does, he teaches us.
Yes.
Everything I give to God, I try to share with you. Sometimes I'm going to overload. I know I overload you sometimes. You're like, now, I'm getting ready to shut it down. I'm getting ready to shut it down. Okay? Now you know. But you got to get to this point. Now, we're in good time. But we got to do baptism and water and baby dedication. I mean, really. We're in good time. It's only 10 after that. Okay? Alright, so if you put me on the time clock, y'all should be looking for word, not time.
Come on.
Trying to get some word. Look at this. Skip. What's Skip? Bring Regina back up with you, please. Anyway, verse number 16. You have not, listen to this, y'all gotta get this part because I highlighted some of the things. Okay, brothers, before y'all start moving everybody, hold on everybody, okay. It say, you have not chosen me, but I want you to get this. Because remember the whole message was ordained. And ordained for to be productive and successful. Look, I want you to get this. He say, but I have chosen you. This is Jesus still speaking.
Thank you, Lord.
And ordained you that you should bring forth, that you should go and bring forth what?
Fruit.
And that your fruit should what?
Amen.
He said that whatsoever you should ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. Now look at this. He said, you have been chosen and ordained. Now everyone understand what chosen means. I just want to break this word down, ordained, and we're going to go ahead. I want you to get this. The word ordained is to invest, to select, to appoint or assign to an office or function. to order, establish, or enact with authority. I like this part. To decree, appoint, or predestine irrevocably. Okay? Y'all got it?
Amen.
Now listen, listen, because I'm going to say something. I want you all to get this. Because some of us, we think ordained, we're not talking about man's ordination. We're talking about God's ordination. We're talking about why God ordained us. And we need to know that we have an assignment. God has given us an appointment. God has given us something to do on this earth while we're here. God did not just give us something so we could order him around, so he can make our day better, so he can make our lives better. He gave us an assignment. He ordained us to be successful. He ordained us to be productive, to be fruitful. So again, it is to invest, to select, to appoint, to assign to an office or function, to order, to establish, or enact with authority, to decree, appoint, or predestine irrevocably. So we have to understand that this is what God has done. God has selected us. This is the chosen. He selected us, folks. We have been selected. Once he selected us, he invested in us. Y'all got it?
Amen.
He has invested in us. There are things that God has invested in us that we don't even know about. God has invested in you. God has invested in me. Every citizen of God's kingdom, he has invested very highly into. God has ordered. He's ordered some things for you. There are some things that God has ordered. He ordered your step. He's ordered your path. He orders finances to come to your life if you are where you're supposed to be when the order comes through.
Amen.
He appointed you. Amen.
Amen.
He has an assignment for you. So you have been assigned. You have been appointed. You have been ordered. He's invested in you. He's been selected. He ain't done yet. He has established you. All this is in the Word. You have been established by God.
Thank you.
God has decreed that he got something for you. God has delegated you to authority and power. He has predestined irrevocably his call on your life. God has enacted kingdom authority in your life.
Thank you, Lord.
For the sole purpose of making sure that all of God's citizens, all of his citizens of the kingdom, to become highly productive and highly successful. This is what God orders for him, for you to do. He's looking for you to fulfill your assignment. He has invested, he has put in you, he selected, he's done all these things so that you can become highly productive and highly successful.
Amen.
We cannot accept good enough when we know that God has something best. So, this is in closing. Remember, you have to get this part together too. In John 15 and 17, he says, these things, out of the King James, I have commanded you that you what?
Love.
Notice this is the conclusion of this particular part. See, if we don't get this part right, we're going to miss everything else. He said, I have commanded that you love one another. The Message Bible says like this. This is my command. Love each other.
Amen.
And after that, it goes a little deeper. It says, this is what I command you. That you love and unselfishly seek the best for one another.
Amen.
That you unselfishly seek the best for one another. That's the kind of love
Amen.
That we got to have. It cannot be individualism. It's got to be part of the body working together. That we truly have the kind of culture that people know that these people are joking. They actually love each other. They serious. They ain't let you run another one down.
Come on
now. They ain't gonna commit. You know, back in the day, you know, I'd get mad at my brother, but you better not mess with it.
No. Amen.
And my brother may be fighting, but don't you jump in.
Amen.
We'll both get you.
Right.
Y'all, that's family. Hey. That's how family. We family, y'all. We're part of God's kingdom. And we need to be serious about this. Let's learn to do this. And let's let God purge us of all the dead works.
Amen, amen.
All the things that really have no real significance. Stuff we've been holding on to. Because he's trying to get us in position to reach our fullest potential.
Thank you, Lord.
He wants us to be abundantly productive. He wants us to be successful. He wants us to be fruitful in every area, in every work. I'm sure that took all in the Bible. That was the first commandment. Let them be fruitful. The man and the woman. Let them be fruitful. So, as we prepare to close, I want you to understand this, that where we are today in our spiritual walk, God has so much more for us. Not just the spiritual things. But I could serve a lot better if I didn't have debt.
Come on, Pat.
Come on.
Amen.
I could.
Amen.
I would like to just give. I wish I had the money where I can just pay off the mortgage. I'm just doing it. If I had the money, I'm serious. I'll pay it off. I'll say, let me write a check then.
Amen.
But you know, I have to get to the point where I can trust Him with it.
Amen.
See, because God's not going to give us, we'll say that now, see? But if we had $5 million, would we give God $1 million?
Come on.
We'll give
Him
$500,000. What are we doing? We can say it if we don't have it. But if we had it, what are we doing? If that's the case, if we got $100, would we give God $2 million?
Amen.
Are we free to do that? Do we have an issue with it? Or are we disciplined enough to where we say, you know what, if I can get in better condition with my health, where I can serve God more, then I'm going to do something to try to come more distant so I can do things I need to do. I don't always be tired.
Amen.
One day we're going to get sick and tired of being sick and tired.
Amen.
See, it's about a discipline thing. Are we going to get too many hand claps without that?
Amen.
Because that means now, see, we take it away from what God can do. Now we're talking about what we need to do. Every time we talk about that, that joy just kind of just goes. It's like you put a slow leak in a tire. It's like, shh. He was all right to it. He started saying something along the way.
Amen.
Then you got to pump him back up and say, God, I'm going to do that. So all of a sudden, that inflated. And then you say, okay, but here's what you need to do. Then you get deflated.
Amen.
I'm trying to help you. I'm trying to give you a balanced message.
Amen.
Because
amen.
I love you,
thank
you,
Lord.
Too much.
Thank God for
that. Continue. I got to take you.
Thank you. Amen.
I got to give you both sides of this message. Not one side.
Yes.
I refuse to compromise the word of God.
Amen.
Just so we can draw more people.
Thank you, Lord.
I got to tell you the truth. Tell her, I got to give you the truth.
Thank you.
Amen. Amen.